All praises be to Allah, and may Allah's peace and blessings be upon His Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Whoever Allah guides, nobody can misguide him, and whoever Allah leads astray, nobody can get him, on the right path. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make this class of benefit to us in this life and in the hereafter, and for all those who hear it, who listen to it. Last time we talked about al-ijma'a, and before the point of al-ijma'a, just a point in the meanings of the Arabic language that we need to discuss and shed light on is the sometimes السياق العلماء they say السياق يقيد المعنى. I believe we talked about the meaning sometimes, and sometimes the there might be an ayah or a hadith, okay? If you take it out of context, it will mean something else. If one put it in the right context, you will know what it means. For example, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that's why in the Quran you will find, we'll just give example to some gestures like, smiling, okay? Smiling, sometimes one might smile, but his smile does not connote pleasure. Okay? It may mean he's angry or upset about something. And sometimes the laughter or smiling, okay, might mean, he's happy. But from the context, you will know it. And the Prophet when Ka'b ibn Malik came to him after he was from Mukhallafin, he was of those who left in Medina, being left in Medina, so he could have done it because he had the means and everything and should have been with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in that battle. When he came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, فَتَبَسَّمَ لِي تَبَسُّمَ الْمُغْضَبِ. So he smiled into me, in a smile that I feel that it connotes his displeasure or his anger, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that he was upset. In the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says about Sulaiman alayhi salam, when he heard about, the ant, when the ant said, وَقَالَتْ نَمْلَةٌ يَا أَيُّهَا النَّمْلُ, ants, ادخلوا مساكنكم, get, enter your reside or your houses, your halls, lest Sulaiman and his soldiers will, crush you or destroy you, وهم لا يشعرون, and they are not feeling, are not aware about that. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said, فَتَبَسَّمَ ضَاحِكًا مِنْ قَوْلِهَا. If you would have said, فَتَبَسَّمَ مِنْ قَوْلِهَا, it could have mean, we don't know. What does that تَبَسَّم mean? But when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said, فَتَبَسَّمَ ضَاحِكًا مِنْ قَوْلِهَا, it means, he smiled and laughed that, being astonished of how eloquent this, and said to its people, okay? So realization of the meaning sometimes connote something, but from the context, you will know it that it is only, it has only one meaning. For example, we mentioned once that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَكَتَبْنَا عَلَيْهِمْ فِيهَا أَنَّ النَّفْسَ بِالنَّفْسِ وَالْعَيْنَ بِالْعَيْنِ وَالسِّنَّ بِالسِّنِّ وَالْأُذْنَ بِالْأُذْنِ وَالْجُرُوحَ قِصَاصِ. Then if it was like this, it could have been some general, okay? But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when he said, فَمَنْ تَصَدَّقَ بِهِ فَهُوَ كَفَّارَةٌ لَهُ, we realized that, you know, qisas, okay, what you can say, what the Sharia had made as a fixed punishment for anyone who would do something, and retaliation becomes the same, from the same kind, if a person, for example, break, you know, a finger for a person would break his finger. If he, for example, you know, made a wound, then a wound like it could be done to him. At the end, if it was so general like that, it might include non-Muslims. But when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَمَنْ تَصَدَّقَ بِهِ فَهُوَ كَفَّارَةٌ لَهُ, we come to realize that it is only for the believers, because it cannot, you know, be a sadaqah and a kafara and expiation for a disbeliever, and so on. So from the context, we would sense could mean acceptance, and sometimes could mean no. It's not an acceptance. So it depends on the situation. In this regard, the hadith of the Prophet, when he talked about the girl which has not reached, you know, which is a virgin woman, or a virgin girl, you should realize that their excuse is what? Is their silence. While a woman that has been married before, it should be to stammer. It should be asked, and it should be, it should give her consent to a marriage or not. Okay. Now, silence her could mean, okay, her consent and her agreement. But if she, for example, would go back and say to her mother that I'm not, you know, I couldn't say to my father, I don't want him. This is another story, okay? A general and she must put her agreement. In the hadith of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, when Umar radiallahu anhu, he heard that the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam divorced all of his wives, and he came and he found the Sahaba, you know, weeping and crying for such news, which would be no doubt a great, you know, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect, you know, these Sahaba and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and his wives, render them safe from such, it would be a disaster, especially for Umar. His daughter was the mother of the believer. So when he came and he asked the Sahaba, they were weeping and crying in the masjid of the Prophet, they said to him that the Prophet divorced all of his wives. Umar, he couldn't stand that the Prophet would do such. So he went and he asked the guard, Rabah, who was, you know, or Aflah, I forgot the name of the servant, okay, the Prophet at that stance, he asked him to tell the Prophet to excuse, and to get an excuse for him. So he said, he went to the Prophet and the Prophet did not say anything. When he came to him, he said, I mentioned your name to him and he didn't say anything. Umar did not, you know, get such silence as acceptance. Rather, he returned back to the masjid and he came again, and the third time the Prophet, you know, gave his consent. He said, let him in. So we come to realize that from the context, we know what's the meanings, okay? Or let's say, let's be more specific, we restrict the meaning to one of the, you know, the meanings that situation or that words or that sentence might have meant a general meaning, okay? This is one of the points that the ulama, they sometimes say. When we talked about ijma', and we said that ijma' is the agreement, okay? And we said in the technical meaning, it means the agreement of all scholars or most of the scholars. And we mentioned that there might be many of them agreed and some of them had not shown any, what you can say, any opinion contrary to what those group or realm of the ulama said. Their silence here could mean, okay, acceptance and agreement. And the ulama, they said there is ijma' sukuti and there is ijma', okay, bilqaw. The agreement, he said, of all scholars worthy of making legal decisions from the Ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam after his death. Because at his death, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you know, at his lifetime, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, nobody could make any agreement aside from what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decides and his prophet. That's why the Sahaba, they used to say to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, whenever he would ask them, after Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed the ayah, فَلَا وَرَبِّكَ لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ حَتَّى يُحَكِّمُوكَ فِي مَا شَجَرَ بَيْنَهُمْ ثُمَّ لَا يَجِدُوا فِي أَنفُسِهِمْ حَرَجًا مِمَّا قَضَيْتَ وَيُسَلِّمُوا تَسْلِيمًا. And the other ayah, وَمَا كَانَ لِمُؤْمِنٍ وَلَا مُؤْمِنَةٍ إِذَا قَضَى اللَّهُ وَرَسُولُهُ أَمْرًا أَن يَكُونَ لَهُمُ الْخِيَرَةُ مِنْ أَمْرِهِمْ. It was not a fitting for a believer, male or female, to have their own choice aside from that of Allah and His Messenger. And when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the Quran, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لَا تُقَدِّمُوا بَيْنَ يَدَيِ اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ, do not, you know, proceed in the presence, okay, of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That's why all of us, we should not proceed to say any opinion unless we go back to the Quran, to the Sunnah, and to the Ijma' of the Sahaba, and to the saying of the noble scholars of Islam who are, alhamdulillah, you know, some of them are living and some of them, you know, they used to say, Allahu wa Rasuluhu a'lam. Whenever the Prophet ﷺ would ask sometimes for trivial things, for obvious things, أَيُّ بَلَدٍ هَذَا, they know that it was Mecca, it was Bayt al-Haram. They said, Allahu wa Rasuluhu a'lam. Why they would say to something known to them, Allah and His Messenger know best? Because they do not want to proceed in the presence of Allah and His Messenger. Excuse me, you can stop. I have to answer this call. As we said that at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, there can be no ijma' for anyone. Why? Because the wahi is being in revelation. After the death of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the Sahaba, may Allah be pleased with them, you know, could look at the ijma', and we mentioned last time that Abu Bakr and the Muhajirin and the Ansar used to gather sometimes for, you know, for ijma'. And ijma is always based on evidences from the Quran or from the Sunnah of the Prophet. We gave an example also with the story of Umar when he was heading for Tabuk, sorry, for Sham. And on the midway, he heard about Ta'un, the plague, and he couldn't, you know what to exactly do. So it seemed, and Allah knows best, that Umar was content that he should return back, he should retreat and go back to Medina. Yet the Sahaba disagreed, as we mentioned, and he called upon the Muhajirin, and Allah knows best. If those Muhajirin would have agreed on something, Umar would not have gone to others. And this is the agreement. Huh? Muhajirin, they are the grand scholars or the grand immigrants of Islam who had witnessed the Wahi and who could be the most knowledgeable amongst the Sahaba. Okay? But as we know, they disagreed amongst themselves. Okay? So Umar, he said to them, okay, leave me alone. And he got the Ansar and they disagreed, saying, some of them said we should march on, go to Sham, and some of them, they said we should return back. And he called upon the junior Muhajirin, the immigrants after conquering Mecca, and all of them were in agreement that they should return back, you know, to Medina. Say, subhanAllah, the most knowledgeable and the best disagreed, and those agreed. Those who migrated after conquering Mecca, they were committed to seeking knowledge, and you know, most of the knowledge of the deen was, you know, clearer, or was, we can say, the rules and the fundamental concepts were clear to them, okay, than those grand sahaba. It doesn't mean that those sahaba, you know, were not having knowledge. Huh? They agreed to return back. So we said the agreement to follow scholars, worthy of making legal decisions from the Ummah of Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. And again, we said Ummah here means those who accepted the messengership of Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Means they are the Muslims, huh? Because his Ummah is more than the Muslims. All those whom the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam was sent to is from his Ummah, jinn and bin, okay? And he said also on a religious matter, because we are not talking about, you know, the matter is the worldly matter. And he said in any period in time, in any period in time, because it might happen that, you know, things would go on, you know, till the day, or till Allah, you know, finishes this life. Now, we talked about explanation in general last time, and we give some examples of ijma', okay? And for example, one of the agreements, okay, that the Sahaba had, is they agreed that the divorced woman from a revocable divorce during her waiting period is entitled to adequate financial support and residence. Okay? They agreed on this, revocable. Huh? So one should see their agreement and their ijma' was for the divorced woman who are still in her waiting period, and the divorce is a revocable one. Okay? Any, either after the first divorce or the second divorce. But the third divorce, there is, you know, the most correct opinion that she is not entitled for support or residence. these are all examples of the ijma'. Today, inshallah, we'll just have the proofs that ijma' is legal evidence. It is an evidence from the evidences of Sharia. So what are the evidences? The proof that ijma' is regarded as one of the sources that we should resort to. You can read, Sheikh Abdul-Majid.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Proof that ijma' is legal evidence. The majority of scholars agreed that ijma' is proof and it is compulsory to work with it. The Nizami, the Shia, and the Khawarij disagreed with this. The Jumhur, the majority of scholars, have proven its evidence by many proofs. Among them are, number one, Allah's words in the Quran. وَمَنْ يُشَاقِقِ الرَّسُولَ مِنْ بَعْدِ مَا تَبَيَّنَ لَهُ الْهُدَى وَيَتَّبِعْ غَيْرَ سَبِيلِ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ وَلِّهِ مَا تَوَلَّى نُصْلِهِ جَهَنَّمْ وَسَاءَتْ مَصِيرًا. It translates, if anyone contends with the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, even after guidance has been plainly conveyed to him, and follows a path other than that, becoming to men of faith, we shall leave him the path he has chosen and make him enter hell. What an evil refuge. Allah the Supreme has warned those who follow a path other than that of the believers with punishment, so it becomes incumbent to follow their way. What is this save an evidence? Number two, the saying of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, لا يزال من أمتي أمة قائمة بأمر الله. A group of my followers will always remain on the right path. So if the people of a particular time agreed on something evil, it would have negated the correctness of this hadith in that time due to the absence of supporters of the truth, and this is invalid. Therefore, invalid too is the possibility of their agreeing on what is contrary to the truth.
Okay. Stop, Zach. You can stop there. Those are the main two evidences the ulama usually establish, the fact that ijma' is the third source, you know, from the sources of fiqh in Sharia. And the evidence is very clear to whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guides his heart to the deen of Allah. Okay? The problem with the, you know, the Shia and the Khawarij, okay, and you know, some of those groups, deviant groups, unfortunately, the Shia and the Khawarij, they all in disagreement with the Sahaba, may Allah pleased with them. That's why, you know, they couldn't accept that ijma' is legal evidence. Okay. For the Khawarij, they want to do with them by their own. Going back and referring back to the ulama. And I remember that, you know, unfortunately, two Kharijis who used to, or yani those who are if we can give them the same name, Kharijis, yani they are taking the same trend. Two youngsters were making takfir on we can say one of the talabat al-ilm, one of the knowledge seekers, and this knowledge seeker, he came to them to try to convince them that what the decision they took is not right. And he started to speak to them, and he couldn't get them to, you know, to agree with him in any way. So he asked them a question to find out what would happen to them both. And they disagreed, you know, in such question. And they started, every one of them started making takfir on the other one. Okay. And this is always the problem of the, you know, the person who doesn't have knowledge. When he starts to talk about things without, you know, without referring back to usul. So the person who says, I can understand Quran by my own without the sunnah, he would be deviant, no doubt about it. He will deviate, no doubt about that. And he who would say, I can understand the Quran and Sunnah by myself, without referring back to the ulama, to the scholars of Islam, to what the Sahaba said, and he would again, you know, be a deviant. Unless a person goes through these three ways, you know, the Quran and the Sunnah, and then the ijma' of the Sahaba, of the Ummah, or the Sahaba, or the ulama of the Ummah. If he does not go to this, he will be different. So we said the Jumhur, majority, and why I talked about Khawarij more Shia than Shia, because the Shia way is well known that they are so deviant because they give asma and infallibility to their own imams aside from, you know, the Sahaba and the ulama. And this is a problem, no doubt about it, okay? Let me why we don't talk about Shia much is due to the fact that, okay, that the Shia they don't have any base. Even the Quran, you know, they doubt it. Okay, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say this. And they say this Quran is nothing compared to the true Quran, they claim, which was with Fatima رضي الله عنها. Most of the realm of the Shia or their scholars, you know, believe that Quran is distorted, أعوذ بالله. Okay, then what's left from the deen for us? Nothing. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save us from such deviation. Now, he gave the first evidence. وَمَنْ يُشَاقِقِ الرَّسُولَ مِنْ بَعْدِ مَا تَبَيَّنَ لَهُ الْهُدَى وَيَتَّبِعْ غَيْرَ سَبِيلِ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ نُوَلِّهِ مَا تَوَلَّى وَنُصْلِهِ جَهَنَّمْ وَسَاءَتْ مَصِيرًا. So whoever, okay, contends with the messenger, okay, whoever become in opposition to the way of the Prophet ﷺ, to his, you know, authentic sunnah known, you know, and transmitted to us, you know, authentically, after the guidance is shown to him, has been plainly conveyed and shown to him. After that, if he would follow a path other than the path, okay, that yani, the and adopt it, he will have, you know, he will be dismissed and, you know, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save us, destined to hell, okay, forever, okay, and he will enter hell, and what an evil, you know, refuge for him, what an evil end for him, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save us. If you look at this ayah, it talked about the messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and it talks about من بعد ما تبين له الهدى. Okay. Now, if he comes to realize that this is the way of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and this is what the believers, you know, or the general, you know, masses of the men of faith adopted, this is the guidance. Now he would become in opposition to it and contend against that, or with hell, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save us. And this is what, and if this cannot be an evidence, then what evidence we can give to the ijma'? Okay, especially after it tells وَيَتَّبِعْ غَيْرَ سَبِيلِ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. So, yani, here, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not mention, you know, يَتَّبَعْ غَيْرَ سَبِيلِ أَصْحَابِ الرَّسُولِ, or those who lived with the Prophet ﷺ. He made it so general. غَيْرَ سَبِيلِ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. Okay? Also the saying of the Prophet ﷺ, لَا يَزَالُ مِنْ أُمَّةِ أُمَّةٌ قَائِمَةٌ بِأَمْرِ اللَّهِ. A group of my followers will always remain on the right path. So if the people of a particular time agreed on something, okay, and if a realm of people would agree on evil, it would have negated the correctness of this hadith. And you cannot find the Muslims, you know, they would agree on something in generality of the ummah. So he said, in that time, due to the absence of supporters of the truth, and this is invalid. But therefore, invalid too is the possibility of their agreeing on what's contrary to the truth. Okay. So ijma' al ummah, even the ummah in its entirety, if they make agreement to something, you know, that does not, I mean, we are not talking about the masses, okay, the general masses of the Muslims, aside from the ulama of the ummah who are known for their ilm and their knowledge, even if they are of different madhabs, okay? Well, I mean, those two main, you know, hadith shows the ijma'. The Prophet ﷺ said, عليكم بسنتي وسنة الخلفاء الراشدين المهديين من بعدي. So he talked about his way and the way of those rightly guided caliphs after him. We come to realize that there is, you know, something after him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, which is the ijma'. We'll stop here, inshallah, and next week we'll carry on from the and talk about the time of ijma'. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide us to the way most pleasing to him. If you have any questions, you can ask any question. If no questions, inshallah, we'll stop here. And next week, inshallah, we'll meet. Allah reward you for your attentive listening. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward you for your attentive listening. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make what we said of benefit to all of us, increase us all in religion and faith. Allahumma nuffiqna lima tuhib wa tarda. Allahumma ihfaz biladana wa bilad al muslimin min al waba wa min المنكرات ومن مساوئ الأخلاق يا رب العالمين. اللهم احفظ بلادنا من أعدائنا يا رب العالمين أجمعين، المنافقين والكافرين يا رب العالمين، ورد كيدهم في نحورهم يا أكرم الأكرمين. اللهم اجمع قلوب أهل الإسلام على دينك وعلى الحق، واحفظ بهم دينك واحفظ دينك واحفظهم بدينك يا رب العالمين، وأصلح ولاة أمرنا وولاة أمور المسلمين. اللهم اصلح بلادنا هذه وردنا إلى دينك ردا جميلا، واحفظنا يا رب العالمين من ضلة الفتن. سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون، وسلام على المرسلين، والحمد لله رب العالمين، وجزاكم الله خيرا.
عليكم السلام ورحمة الله وبركاته، جزاكم الله خير شيخ.
آمين، والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.